somehow in your awesome plan, you wanted to include us with a relationship with you. That you love us so much. That you wanted us to be a part of you. And right now, Lord, we know that your presence just fills this place. Come and fill us with your Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. When we talk about the Holy Spirit, many of us have all different ideas of what this means. The Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity. And a lot of times, I think a lot of people just get it all wrong by trying to push their own ideas of what this Holy Spirit is and what he does and his ministry. And when I think about that, I think, you know, so many times we can try to figure out God when the scriptures really says, you know, who can know the mind of God? Who are we who are finite beings understand the infinite, awesome creator of this universe? And so we have all kinds of different theology of people trying to shove in their own preconceived ideas of the ministry of this thing called the Holy Spirit. And so I'm going to make an attempt with my human, futile mind to kind of explain what I see when I read scripture, who and what is this thing called the Holy Spirit. And so the idea of being filled with the Holy Spirit, I hope, and I'm not going to ask who in this audience feels the full presence and feel like they're filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, we sang that song, "Fill My Cup, Lord." And can we really be full of the Holy Spirit? And we think of a cup and pouring some liquid into that cup. And you know, one thing is that if you understand the Holy Spirit, you can never get enough of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We as Christians need to hunger and thirst for more of the fullness of God to live within us. And so what my attempt is by sharing some scripture verses with you to understand what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. In Ephesians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul makes an attempt to say, to follow God's example. Now, what kind of example did he set for us? Well, you know, without Jesus himself, God, Jesus, coming to the earth, to walk this earth, and to show how we as people need to live our lives. And it says he was tempted in every way, and yet without sin. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children. And walk in a way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Remember Romans 12? I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, which is pleasing and acceptable to God. This is your spiritual service of worship. The way you live your lives, and you know, I've been to some churches that just seem to go through the motions, and they have all this ceremony. And it means nothing to God. And I think God really detests ceremony if the heart is not right. If we're not living our lives in holiness that is pleasing to God, I think when we come on Sunday and we sing the songs and we go through the motions, it means nothing. And I think God rather you not do that if your actions do not match your act or what you think is an act of worship. And that we as Christians, as we live our daily lives, our offering is pleasing, fragrant sacrifice to God. When we are doing our best to live our life in holiness. It says, but among you there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality or any kind of impurity or of greed. Because these are what? Improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be any obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. So you're at work and somebody throws out a dirty joke and you laugh at it. And then you think of the dirty joke that you want to tell because you want people to laugh at you. How many of you are guilty of that? I know, I am. It's easy to do. But the apostle says, this is not appropriate for you guys. Because people are constantly watching you, and they're watching you, especially if you claim to be a Christian in front of them. They're saying, okay, how does a Christian, what does a Christian look like? And you know what? Sometimes we've got to stop them and say, okay, am I being Christ-like in all that I do? For of this, you can be sure. No immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a person is an idolater and has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Wow, that's pretty strong words. That if you're involved in this type of thing, you don't have a place in God's kingdom. Why? Because God desires for us to be holy. Now some of you are thinking, well, that means I'm not going to go to heaven, right? Because I've done all this stuff. Thanks be to God that all things are possible with Jesus Christ, who paid the penalty for our sins. But our minds should be set on living a holy life, not just kind of taking things for granted and saying, well, Jesus died for my sins so I can do whatever I want to. That's the wrong attitude. He says, let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's what? Wrath comes on those who are disobedient. I think maybe God can understand those that don't know him to live the way they live, because that's what how those type of people live, right? But for Christians, he desires us to live in holiness. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once, that's the past, in darkness, but now, the present, you are light in the Lord. Live as children of the light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. You know, sometimes we think that nobody's watching, right? When we're involved in sin. You understand what I'm saying? Nobody's watching. But who matters the most? The person that can see every single thing that you're doing. God can see every single thing. Think every moment of the day that you're doing. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. And everything that is illuminated by becomes a light. And that is why it says, wake up, sleeper! Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. You know why this world is such a mess? Because people have formulated their own ideas on how this world should be. And they have rejected God. And they are living in a world of evil and buying into the lies of the devil himself. It says, do not get drunk on wine or anything else that kind of alters your mind. You see, the thing is that, why is it that people, after you get off of work, they want to rush to the bar and think they're having a great time, making a fool of themselves, because they're trying to find this joy to fill that empty void in their lives that only the Holy Spirit can fill. And so they get intoxicated and let the demons take over, and yet they feel happy. But then they're really miserable because it's a lie. It is not the truth. So he says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. People do stupid things when they get drunk and intoxicated, right? Instead, be filled, that empty place, be filled with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, living in your lives and enabling you to do and live the holy life that God wants you to. And speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Make music from your heart to the Lord. You see, when you are filled with the Spirit, then the things that really count, that when you encourage each other and when we come together in worship before the Lord as a congregation, we can actually sing from joy because the Holy Spirit is just working in our lives, and we can sing out and praise to Him. Well, what an awesome God we serve. He says, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, this has been a really tough week for me. It seems like wherever I go, my phone has been constantly ringing off the wall. With this and that and that and that and that. I mean, just constant. And it has kind of worn me down this week. And it's not a bad thing, but it's just that when you are trying to minister to several different people at the same time, it can be weary. And then, you know, it's like, you know that term, you put the pedal to the metal? You know, when you're going as fast as you can go, and then, you want to go faster, you want to do more. And I have come to the conclusion that I am not omnipresent. I cannot be in two places at the same time. And some of you know what I'm talking about. And I try to ask people to help me because they can go in my place, type of thing. But you know what? We serve an awesome, omnipresent Creator. God,
amen.
Who gives us the strength. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength.
Yes.
And you know what really helps me is to be able to just live in the Spirit of the Lord and find my strength in Him. Because in Him, the fullness of God dwells within bodily form, within us. But the thing is, you know, some of you who have become Christians, right, have the Holy Spirit living in you. You know what? The Spirit does live in you, but we don't tap into the power of God. And that's the key, is trying to tap into the Holy Spirit and gain from God what He desires in your life. And I've been talking to different people this week and on how God has given each and every one of you a gift. And He wants you to use that gift to glorify Him. Again, you know, how would it be in this world if they were all doctors? Everybody is doctors, but there's no cooks. How many of you enjoy that, huh? I don't think you'd enjoy that too much. Or how about if they were all cooks and there's no doctors? Or what if everybody was a preacher and there is no congregation out there? Everybody's on the stage preaching to nobody. That wouldn't work too good, would it? And when I think about, okay, how does a person get filled with the Holy Spirit? Because I think we all desire more, right? Is there anybody that don't want more of God? And I gotta go back to the day of Pentecost. Peter, you know, after all his denial and his reinstatement with Jesus asking, you know, do you love me? And feed my sheep and all that. And here he is, boldly standing up, proclaiming the name of Jesus. You guys killed him. They were convicted. It says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this, that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. And when the people heard this, they were convicted. They were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, what do we do? I realize that I am in a bad position right now. What am I going to do to be saved? And so Peter replies, repent. Stop doing that bad stuff. Turn around and live a holy life. Repent and be baptized. Some of you.
All.
Everyone.
Isn't that what people teach today? You don't have to be baptized. Peter right here says, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will, this is a promise, you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The third person of the Trinity, God living within us, you will receive the Holy Spirit. Not part of Him. God is omnipresent and He, all of Him, lives within you. You get that? That's the gift. That when you humble yourselves and realize that you cannot make it on this earth on your own, and you turn it over to God, you have the Holy Spirit come and live within your life. That is a guarantee. The promise is for you, your children, and for all those who are far off. I'm glad you talked about those who are far off, because that includes all of us. For all. And what was the word all mean?
All.
For all who call, who the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, He warned them, He pleaded with them, save yourself from this corrupt generation. And those who accepted the message, what did they do? They got convicted and they were baptized. And about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Now, if you want to talk about inconvenience, try baptizing 3,000 people. Can you imagine? I mean, what is that percentage of the town of Alliance? Can you imagine if all of a sudden every single person in the city of Alliance got convicted? They realized that they were the ones that put Jesus on the cross. Because everyone who has sinned has put Jesus on the cross. Jesus died for them. Can you imagine the whole town of Lions coming to know Lord Jesus Christ and be filled with the Holy Spirit?
Amen.
They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, the breaking of bread, and to prayer. And everyone was filled with